Yo.
Hey, shit, what's up, dude?
What up, buddy? How's it going?
I'm doing fucking great, man. I'm talking to my childhood hero.
This is really happening, huh? Pretty cool.
Yeah, I remember hating every day of my senior year of high school because you'd turn into a massive asshole and stop writing articles. What the fuck?
Yeah, I did a Reddit AMA a long time ago. By the way, is my voice coming in okay? Does it sound clear?
Yeah, it sounds perfect.
All right, cool. I did a Reddit AMA a while back after I wrote The Alphabet of Manliness, and a lot of people were like, "Oh, Maddox, what happened? How come you're not updating your website as much anymore?" Honest truth is, like, I just got burnt out.
Sure.
That book took a lot out of me to write, so I finally finished it, and here I am. I'm back to doing a weekly podcast. So anyway.
Sure. Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, obviously in the beginning. And then to be frank, right? I mean, there's no money or monetization there or anything too, and the big projects probably take a fuck ton of time, I imagine.
Oh yeah, they really do. Everybody asks me, like, "Hey, how do I become a writer?" And my number one response to them is, "Don't do it. It's awful. It's a shit ton of work. It's miserable. It's it's thankless. You have to fight your demons every day. It's just a pain in the ass."
Sure. So, I guess just curious, we don't. Do you have like a specific thing you want to talk about, or are we just kind of chatting, or?
Oh man, I mean, we could chat about everything. I just got off another stream I did just now with where we discussed pizza and gourmet pizza specifically and how much I hate that shit. And Chick-fil-A, I actually got in an argument with a Chick-fil-A employee about the number of pickles they put on their sandwich. It's those two tiny bullshit little pickles that they put on. Do you like Chick-fil-A sandwiches?
I have very strong opinions about some fast food. I think Chick-fil-A is very overrated, so I'm gonna reserve
Amen.
mine.
Absolutely. It's so overrated.
Yeah. Their waffle fries are like pretty good, but their chicken is very meh. It's not bad, but it's like really overhyped. The first time I went to Chick-fil-A, I was really excited, or Chick-fil-A, because I thought I was gonna get some amazing ass shit, and it was just like, okay.
So overrated. The best fast food chicken sandwich is Wendy's spicy chicken.
Yeah, I mean, probably. There's not much to argue there. I mean, it's really good. I mean, I don't think there's a lot of like fast food, like super amazing chicken sandwiches, so I'm not even sure what else I'd compare it to. But yeah, I mean, Wendy's is really good. Sure.
Hey, so dude, I gotta tell you, I gotta be honest. Until just like a week or so ago, I wasn't really aware. I think I'd heard of you on Twitch, but I of course, like everyone on the internet, tuned in to see that amazing JonTron debate.
Yeah.
And so, how did that even come to be? What led up to that?
Basically, starting back like a year ago, I've always been very, I've been interested in talking about a lot of issues like political or ethical or moral or whatever. So these have always been kind of like a regular thing on my stream. As of a year ago, well, maybe not quite a year ago, maybe like 6 to 8 months ago, we started to talk about politics a lot more. We followed the US election very closely, and all of the political conversations with all the different kinds of groups of people have always been like a very big part of my stream and, you know, grew massively recently. And part of the people that I talk to have been, I don't even know what the fuck to call them anymore. It's not really the alt-right, but like the alt-light, but also people on the alt-right and the race realists and all of that. And then I noticed a while ago, do you know who Sargon of Akkad is?
Yeah, I just started chatting with him as well.
Yeah, so I talked to him a month ago or two about some things, and I noticed that JonTron and him had a conversation where they got pulled into where they were just talking on the internet, and it was pretty circle jerky, and JonTron said a lot of surprising things. And after I heard that, you know, me and JonTron got into a little meme on Twitter. And my go-to thing on Twitter is always like, yo, let's talk on voice, because Twitter is shit for conversations. And I like voice conversations because, you know, you can hash out your ideas really well, clarify points and everything. So yeah, and surprisingly, he accepted. I didn't think he would, but then he came on and talked. I expected that he was going to kind of not walk back on, but, you know, back away from a lot of the more extremist thoughts that it seemed like he was expressing, but he went a lot deeper than I thought he was going to. I didn't think that was a conversation where either of us were going to be uttering the phrase gene pool. So, yeah.
Did you see the ETC show, I guess recap and summary of your debate?
Yeah, I watched it all, yeah.
Yeah, I'm friends with those guys, Ricky and Elliot. They're awesome. But
Oh, cool.
one thing in particular that they said, I think, is going to probably turn out to be true, which is, there was a big upset with his fan base. A lot of people threatened to unsubscribe and stop supporting him. His entire subreddit seemed to turn against him. And Rick and Elliot just had a very level-headed approach towards that, which is they said that, look, at the end of the day, you're going to lose a lot of the left-leaning and liberal people, but then you're probably going to make up for it with with the right-leaning. So it's probably going to be a wash. And I've been keeping an eye on the subscriber count, and it seems to be the case.
Yeah, and for the most part, I wouldn't expect anything like this to stick, because it's not that I want it to. I'm really big on that. I don't like career assassination. Right. I've had people try to do it to me a lot. I'm sure that you've dealt with people trying to do it to you.
My whole career.
Yeah. So I'm never big on that. I don't want JonTron to lose anything. And to some extent, the reason why people get pushed into these positions so much is because of the career assassinating mentality and whatnot. So I don't want to see JonTron like lose all of his subs or anything. I'm very big on separating the art from the artist. I'm still a fan of yours, even after I found out you didn't look anything like the big burly pirate that you represented yourself with in all of your comics and everything.
Hey, you know, that's bullshit. I absolutely do. Okay, you got to adjust your eyes.
maybe my monitor resolution is off. Maybe in the old 600x400 CRTs, it would look a little bit more true to life. But
that's probably, you know, it might be a combination of things. Yeah. Okay, buddy, it's the resolution. It's a number of things going on. I don't know. Sure.
But yeah, no, I think, I don't want like the big, like the huge backlash and everything. I don't think it does anybody well. It just causes everybody to burrow into their positions even more, you know? Nobody's ever changed their mind by being screamed down at by the opposition, you know?
Right, right. My approach towards the whole thing, I mean, a lot of people try to emulate me and they don't really get what I'm trying to do or what I do. I'm very opinionated. I'm very pointed with my opinions. I have a lot of strong beliefs, but I never shove it down people's throats. I never knock on their door, go to their forums, harass them and threaten them and do all that bullshit. If someone sees my opinions, they're coming to me for it. I'm not going to them. And that's the difference. And sometimes I'll get into it with people who email me. And I'm a big fan of giving people chances. When people email me, throughout my career, there have been two times where people have lost their jobs indirectly because of me. And it didn't make me feel good. That's not something I ever aspire to do. I don't want to ruin people's lives because of a comedy. I don't want that to ever to be the case. But when it comes to a point where the harassment doesn't stop, people keep this guy, for example, I'll give you an example. The first time it ever happened to me, this guy sent me an email from his work email address and started to call me, fucker, shithead, just harassing me over and over and over again. And I told him to stop. I said, hey, man, you should stop for a number of reasons. First of all, it's harassment. Second, you're doing it from your work address. It's really, really stupid. And he's like, I don't give a shit. I said, well, if I post it on my website, you're going to feel the repercussions of it. He goes, go ahead, do it. I said, look, man, I know you're an idiot, not just because of what you're saying, but because of what's about to happen to you. This is your last chance. Stop. And he didn't. So I posted the email address on my website. I posted the email on my website and just saying like a standard hate mail, right? Mm-hmm. Within a half an hour, this guy's not, he didn't contact me. His brother contacted me and he's like, hey dude, you got to take that email down. The dude just lost his job because everyone's hitting his work website.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh shit. Okay. And he said, by the way, he's really sorry. He was just fucking around, whatever. Just please take it down. So I took it down, of course, because I don't want anyone to lose their jobs over stupid shit like that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that was the first time it happened. It doesn't make me feel good. I want to have an intellectual debate with people. I want to battle them on the, the forum of ideas, but not necessarily, take it to have real world repercussions.
Sure. To clarify, yeah, I'm very big on that. Like, I don't want anybody to lose a job over like an idea or something. But when people start getting into that harassment shit, I lose my patience really quickly.
Absolutely.
For that.
Absolutely.
The worst thing, like, this sucks because you can never talk to anybody about it because people that aren't in our position don't understand. But nothing is worse than having somebody who is shielded by an anonymity.
Yes.
Who is anonymous. Fuck that word. Somebody who is anonymous who can hurl any insult they want at you and then disappear into the shadows after, but every single thing you say to them will be recorded in all of history to be used against you. It's like one of the most frustrating feelings in the world that people can get out and say the most disgusting shit, bring up whatever real life shit they want, you know, and say a million things. And if you slip up and you go too far and you say the wrong thing, then all of a sudden, like, the entire internet rises up against you and you can't go and like change your username and hide behind something else, you know?
Oh, of course. Yeah. You when you have a platform, and this is why I was really surprised with the whole JonTron thing when it went down, because, I've been following his content for a long time. I don't think he knows me. I definitely don't know him. I've never met him or anything, but it's not something I expected from him. But when you have a platform, you really have to tread lightly with your, you know, think about it like a chess move, right? You're not playing, you're not just button mashing in Street Fighter anymore. You're playing chess. And you really have to tread lightly, I think. You can't just go out there unprepared and have a debate about race politics, which was insane. By the way, not to blow sunshine up your ass, but are you a fan of The Daily Show?
With Trevor Noah, like that Daily Show?
Well, I mean, I don't know how, I don't know if anyone's really a fan of Daily Show.
Oh, I didn't know if you meant, if you were talking about a podcast or like The Daily Show. I used to watch Jon Stewart sometimes. I actually listen to a lot of conservative media, but I'm familiar of it with it.
Where do you peg yourself politically? Do you like to label yourself in any way?
I don't like to, because there are some things on both sides that I really disagree with. At this point, if somebody had to label me, I'm probably pretty left-leaning at this point.
Okay. So I also don't like to label myself politically. I think that's one of the biggest problems in this country, is that when you label yourself, you've essentially reduced your political ideology into a sports team, into a slogan, into a symbol. And when you do, you just immediately dismiss anything anyone else is saying by saying, oh, that's a conservative. Oh, he's a cuck.
Yeah.
You're dismissing. You're not entertaining their ideas. It becomes one big ad hominem attack.
I would agree with you there, but I see, yeah, that's probably true. I see people do that no matter what, though. I don't know if the labeling is the important part, because I see people from every side of the spectrum doing shit. You see it happening today with fake news, right? If you're a big fan of Trump and somebody posts something bad about him, that's fake news. It's easy to write it off and disregard every single thing that comes out that doesn't agree with your narrative. I don't know if that's just like a natural human cognitive bias, like a cognitive trap that people fall into or what, but yeah, I know what you're saying. That's really shitty, that playing for a certain team.
What do you think of the landscape of stand-up comedy? First of all, have you ever done any stand-up comedy?
Fuck no.
Okay.
I haven't.
Nothing that's ever interested you, right?
No, it's interesting, but that's a lot of work, and you've got to fuck up a lot of times before you do it well. I put so much time into streaming. I don't have much else to do in life, right? Like, everything that you do online takes so much time and research, and all the political stuff, you know, I've got to read so much and watch so much that, but I mean, yeah, I mean, I enjoy watching it to some extent. I'm not like a super well-versed, like, I've seen all of Carlin's skits. I've seen a little bit of Pryor. I watched a lot of the Louis C.K. dude. I've seen everything by Chappelle, a lot of the old Chris Rock stuff, but I mean, there are people more well-versed than me. I don't know much about like current stand-up comedy. Like, I don't know like who any of the big current names are, other than I guess Louis C.K. is probably big, but I don't like go out and watch a bunch of stand-up or seek it out, you know?
Right. Well, the reason I ask is because, and I want to touch on the amount of work it is to stream. I don't think a lot of people really realize that, but I want to mention the landscape of comedy, I think, is changing and has changed, especially in Los Angeles. I used to go to comedy clubs and just watch a stand-up set, mm-hmm. and the performer would get up on stage and, you know, do his or her thing, and that would be that. You know, they'd get off, and it was done. Now, there's almost like a disclaimer at the start of most major stand-up sets, especially if it's a bigger comic. They will scour the audience and make sure no one's recording it. Because it seems like they want to still have that freedom to test things out, to test out material and things like that. Like, I feel like if JonTron would have probably benefited from that, definitely. Like, if you guys had like a practice debate, and of course, anyone could say that with any debate. Mm-hmm. You want to be a little bit more prepared. But what do you think of that? Do you think that the landscape of comedy is changing because people are able to record everything all the time?
To some extent, yeah. I don't know if that's necessarily like hyper specific to comedy. I think that more plays into that culture of the all of your actions are so permanent these days. Right. If you don't mind me asking, how old are you, or like whereabouts?
I'm 38.
You're 38. Okay, I'm 28. So you know even more so than me. I said some really fucking stupid shit when I was a kid. I'm sure you said and did really fucking stupid shit when you were a kid. Like,
yeah.
I see shit that teenagers post today online when they're 16, 17. And like, you know, I'm laughing alongside everybody else. Like, yeah, guys, these guys sure are stupid. But oh my fucking God, I'm so glad that I didn't have the same type of internet access to be, you know, cataloging all of my totally idiotic thoughts at every stage of my life. It seems there's like two things going on. It's like, one, you have like this permanence of every single fucking thing you do, you know, like is permanently saved forever and archived, you know, for anybody to look up at any point in time, and everything is attached to your real name and, you know, all the shit on Facebook and all of that. And then you have, on the second thing, you have this mob mentality retribution that goes on that is in no way proportional to what you've done, right? As soon as the mob is dictating what your punishment should be, you're fucked, dude. Like, you might as well kill yourself because your life is about to fucking end. And you've seen this happen time and time again, right? The most famous example being that left-leaning woman that tweeted that joke, I'm going to Africa, I hope I don't get AIDS, oh wait, I'm white, right? She was saying that because black people are fucked in Africa, and she's a left-leaning person. It was like a tongue-in-cheek thing. But by the time she landed, her life was over, you know? And this has happened to a lot of people, so I can understand that fear of, like, I don't want to say the wrong thing that's going to get clipped out of context, and now I can't work anywhere because nobody wants to associate with me, you know?
Right, of course. I remember specifically that example. She worked for the company IAC, and someone tracked her down, I think about a year ago, a journalist, to try to get her
article.
Story.
Mm-hmm, yeah, a bunch of those people. Yeah, I remember reading it, yeah.
Yeah, it's fascinating stuff. I mean, the amount of retribution, it seems, is not in any way comparable to the crime, the thing that their alleged sin.
Do you remember the dongle guys?
Which guys?
There are two guys were at some tech conference, and one of them turned to the other. Yeah, and they made like that dongle joke, and that lady turned around and she tweeted a picture of them, and they lost their fucking jobs. That shit was crazy.
That was crazy. She lost her job too. Eventually, yeah. I think they like everybody did. There were no winners from that. It was just
there never is.
There was that tweet. I forget who wrote it, but someone said, you know, the year 2017 said something like, I forgot to, I hope my password isn't leaked. I hope no one sees this private conversation. And then like 2036, it's going to be like, oh, sorry, I'm a little bit late, guys. Today's butthole pick will be up in a few minutes.
Yeah, when your toilet has Wi-Fi and it automatically scans your ass to see if it should shoot water into it or not, and the CIA has, you know, access to every fucking device, or the NSA has access to every device in your house. Yeah, sure.
I mean, do you think that this is an idea I pitched a long time ago? I think it's a good idea. It's a smart idea. All right, it's the best idea.
Okay, Trump. Yeah, go ahead. Let's hear one of the best ideas. Yeah,
it's a beautiful. People say they love this idea. Yeah. So I was thinking that everybody should put their nudes online. All right, there should be one big national database. You know, it's kind of like Facebook, but you can see anyone's genitals. And you just look them up by phone number, email address, whatever. As soon as you turn 18, it's like the national registry. Put your nudes on there. And because here's the thing. You ever hear about a leak from a porn star? Like a nude leak?
No.
No. Nobody cares. Because that's what they have it out. You want to see nude porn stars, you just look. They're already out there. Porn stars are the least vulnerable to leaks. Whereas like celebrities and then, you know, the higher up you go, presidents and senators and politicians. But it's coming. Those days are coming. It's going to happen.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I'm guessing you're probably unaware, but I've already been there. And it's like, I mean, at that point, like, I mean, what are you going to say to hurt me? Like, you know what my dick looks like, dog? Like you can't. I mean, at least people can't call me like a two-incher. Like, I mean, I know what you mean. Like, to some extent, like, if it's already out there, like, who the fuck cares at that point? Yeah.
Oh, no. Well, exactly. I mean, everybody's got one. Oh, well, 50% of the population's got one. And then 50% has the other one.
Yeah.
And then there's a few in between. All right. We get it. Yeah. Everyone's got the same job. I don't know, man. Maybe I'm just getting jaded because I grew up essentially I was the first generation of kid who was able to have complete access to pornography when I, you know, basically hit puberty. And maybe that's like warping us. Maybe we're all just turning into jaded people who are just tired of genitals.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I think I think it plays into like, there's like a lot of, culture there in terms of how we view sex and genitals and all of that. There's a bunch of different talking points there, but yeah, I know what you mean.
Okay, so earlier you touched on the amount of work that you do because you don't really have time to do anything other than stream, right? Mm-hmm. You're streaming all the time. You're very prolific.
Sure.
I don't know if a lot of the viewers, I don't know if this is something you've, instilled in their minds, but how much work it truly is to do what you do.
I mean, I talk about it occasionally. I had like really shit work before this, so I'm of the mindset that I'm like, I'm really grateful that I can do what I do, even, and I get paid obviously very well to do what I do, so I try not to like complain too much. But yeah, I mean, it is a decent amount of work, and there's a lot of mental exhaustion that goes into it too. Another thing that I'm sure you realize is like, we're very bad at people as like, or maybe you could tell me if you do this or not. Do you ever do a thing where like you post an article or a YouTube video and you go through and there's like 55 really positive glowing comments, and then there's that one dude that says something and you get like really pissed off and it like overshadows everything else?
Right. I mean, it used to happen. It used to happen more to me than it does these days.
Yeah, of course.
And I'll tell you why it's changed. But where are you going with this?
Well, I was gonna say there's a lot of shit that you deal with in terms of being even a semi-public figure when people are dissecting your personal life online and shit. I'm very convinced that most people wouldn't be able to deal with that kind of criticism. They might think they can, but I think that, and you see, even popular people I'm sure you're aware of who Total Biscuit is.
Yeah.
Yeah, even very popular people that have been in the public light for a long time, still have massive issues dealing with, I don't even want to say criticism, but unbased personal attacks, things that,
right.
you can't even go out and correct the record because, then you would have to give more personal information that's going to be used to attack you. So you can either sit and say nothing, in which case then, that's a tacit admission that it's true, right? Oh, well, you didn't say shit. So, or you could go out and give more personal information that you're going to be attacked. And it's
right.
There's a lot of shit that goes on mentally. It could be pretty fucking exhausting. Especially if you piss off a certain person. I'm sure that you did this, right? Where an article would go out and you piss off a certain group of people who make it their life's mission to destroy you for the next week or until they get bored and move on to their next target.
Oh, right. It's a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. And people forget that there's a real fucking person behind all of this stuff.
Yeah.
And again, at the end of the day, when someone sends me hate mail, when they're blasting me, when they're attacking me and criticizing me for my work or my looks or anything, at the end of the day, I reply to them sometimes and I say, hey, look, man, what I do on my website, whether you agree with it or not, let's say it's the worst. Okay, let's say I'm bad. I'm a bad person, right? For my opinions. Mm-hmm. What you are doing is you're sending them directly to me. I am not making it personal to you. You are making it personal to me, which makes you infinitely worse because I didn't invite you to read my stuff. If you found my article, it was probably linked from one of your friends, which is who you should probably be complaining to. Sure. To get better taste if you disagree with them. But it's not me. It's not my doing. And they forget that behind the article, behind the writing, behind the persona is still a person. Yeah. And they become absolutely vicious, especially when you have just the veneer of anonymity. Anytime you have anonymity, people are vicious. People are wild. They say and do the most horrible things.
I don't remember if it was a Shakespeare quote or what, but whoever said it hundreds of years ago, give a man a mask and he'll tell you the truth. If he could live to see the way that people act on the internet today, it's the greatest, affirmation of that quote ever.
Hey, so have you been following this Candid shit at all? Do you know what Candid is?
No. Are you referring to candid pictures of Emma Watson being leaked recently? Or?
No.
Sorry.
That
I wasn't trying to make a joke. Sorry.
No, there's an app that was a sponsor on my podcast for a while. It's called Candid, CANDID.
Okay.
And a bunch of YouTubers have also took this on as a sponsor, including Chew on Head, Sargon of Akkad did, and I believe The Amazing Atheist, and myself. I did it as well.
Gotcha.
And the point of Candid, what it is it's an experiment in trying to create an anonymous chatting app that is self-governing. So they have kind of artificial intelligence trying to moderate and see if we can solve this problem through artificial intelligence and moderation. What do you think of that approach towards moderation online?
I mean, it's interesting, but is this a chat program or?
Yeah, it's a chat program where when you join a chat room, mm-hmm. it creates a pseudonym for you. And every time, every single thread that you comment on, it gives you a pseudonym successful beaver or,
sure.
Stoic elephant or smart stork, whatever. It just gives you a pseudonym, so every conversation is anonymous.
What's the difference between this and just posting on the politics threads in 4chan? Or
well, I'll tell you the difference.
A similar idea? Or, sorry.
It is a similar idea, but the difference is for some reason the conversations on Candid are not pure poison. They are not toxic. They are not absolutely cancer like you see everywhere else on the internet when you have an air of anonymity. So I think their auto moderation might be working.
When you say auto moderation, what are you referring to there? What does it do for moderation?
Well, for example, it looks for certain types of patterns of words, and it creates. I think it determines what you're talking about based on the language that you use and the frequency with which you post, and whether or not someone is also using hostile language towards you. So based on context of conversation, it tries to determine how hostile you're being, and it auto-moderates. It also filters for things like doxing, personal information, personal attacks, email addresses, that sort of thing. And when they approached me, they said, hey, we have this anonymous chatting app. Would you like to work with it? I'm like, huh, here we go. This sounds like it's going to be a disaster. But it turned out to be surprisingly civil.
Huh, interesting. I've never seen it, but I mean, it sounds like an interesting idea, sure.
Gives me hope.
It would be nice if we could have conversations without needing apps or whatnot and not be totally cancerous. But yeah, and I mean, I understand what you're saying, sure.
Well, with your own chat forums, I've been keeping, you know, just kind of like glancing at it. I don't know if you want to talk too much about this, but how is the moderation handled on your own end?
Basically, whenever I'm mad, I'd start banning people. There's not too much in terms of moderation on my end.
Okay, let me ask you this. Do you think that's censorship?
Mm-hmm.
You do think that's censorship.
Oh, wait. Do you think what?
When you ban people from your chat forums, do you think that that's censorship?
Technically, yeah.
Okay, interesting.
If you're talking like, is it like a First Amendment violation? I mean, no, it's a private forum, like.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, I don't, because personally, I don't think that's censorship. I think that censorship can only, like, if you ban someone from a forum, it's a private forum, they can go still say their shitty opinions elsewhere, right?
Uh-huh.
They can go say and do whatever they want. But there seems to be this misunderstanding of free speech in this country. And it's usually coming from the right. The right accuses the left of censorship, which, to be fair, the SJW movement, if you follow it to its logical conclusion, will end with a lot of censorship for people, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because they're saying, oh, people are delicate snowflakes, they're hurt by bad words, that sort of thing. But then if you look at the right end of the spectrum, there's a lot of censorship there too, which people don't realize. And I got in an argument recently with someone right-leaning, and I said, yeah, the right censors too. And they said, no, what are you talking about? The right never censors anything. They're all about free speech. You got Milo Yiannopoulos, that sort of thing. I'm like, okay, well, what about burning the flag? Let's start there. How about burning the flag? Do you think, are you for or against the ability to burn flags?
Me personally?
Yeah.
Well, I consider that to be an absolute First Amendment right. There's no, you can't really do anything there.
Absolutely.
You should, yeah.
You should be able to, right?
Yeah.
Okay, people on the right generally would probably scoff at that. A lot of them would be opposed to that. Okay, let's take it a little bit further. What about criticizing our troops? What about protesting our troops?
What about sitting down during the national anthem?
Yeah, what about sitting
Holy
down?
Shit, dude. Do you have any idea how infuriating it was listening to all of these little bobblehead talking pundits? Like, why can't black people just protest without blowing everything up? Why do black people gotta riot all the time? And then, what's his name, Kaepernick or whatever, literally, like, fucking sits down during, and they're like, oh, this is the worst thing fucking black people are trying to destroy. I was like, damn, dude, how the fuck are you supposed to protest? Like, well, he shouldn't be protesting by saying he hates our troops and wants all of them to die of AIDS and cancer. Like, dog, it's protesting the fucking flag. Like, yeah. That really bothers me. Like, that's literally, like, one of the, like, if you could point out, like, what are some of the greatest aspects of America, right? And one of the greatest things is supposed to be criticizing the state and criticizing your leadership. Like, flag burning is the most beautiful part of American freedom. And when people criticize that, I feel like you've lost all perspective, you know?
Right. Absolutely. I think that when it comes to one of the things that infuriates me most with the First Amendment argument, the whole censorship argument, is when someone, like a troop, I don't argue with people who serve in our military, just it's a personal choice, but I see people who do online, and inevitably, it always comes down to this.
Yeah.
It always comes down to the guy who has served getting offended and saying, I fought for your right to say that, right?
Yeah.
And I always think that's such a foolish argument, because essentially the person you're saying that to can turn it around on you and say, you fought for my right to say this.
I agree 100%. I shit on, like, people that do that. I will hardcore shit. I do it to I think my mom is upstairs. She's visiting this week. Hopefully she can't be like, I get into a lot of arguments. They're like, I shit on those people the hardest. Because, like, if you're going to go and die for a country, you got to fucking know what it stands for, dude. And one of the things that it stands for is the right for people to protest, you know, everything that you do. Like, that's part of your shit. Like, why would you go and sign up to be in the military and fight for our constitution without knowing the rights that are protected in it? Like, that's on you, dude, you know?
Yeah, you're fighting for the rights of people you don't like.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, essentially, you're like Commando Jesus. Like, you are sacrificing yourself for people who you disagree with, who you don't like, who you wouldn't even grab a beer with.
Yeah, I don't like what you have to say, but I would die for your right to say it. Right? It's a famous quote. I think one of the big things, and I think both sides are probably guilty of this. I would say maybe the right is more guilty of it at the moment, but people are very big. Well, I say the right is more guilty of it because I don't think a lot of people on the left don't really pretend to be for free speech anymore because they're, you know, depending on how extreme left you go, they very much are into the censorship thing. But it bothers me on the right sometimes when they talk about like free freedom of speech, freedom of everything. But oftentimes with that what that actually means is you are free to do all of the things that I agree with. But if you don't, I fucking hate you, right? Like, I think that freedom of religion is a beautiful thing. But if you're a Muslim, dude, you better watch the fuck out. Like, I got my eye on you. And it's like, damn, dude, like, that's kind of great. Like, freedom of religion is beautiful, but like, you want to wear a hijab in a public school? That's horrible. However, you better keep the Ten Commandments up at this fucking courthouse. And it's like, okay, that's kind of strange. My tax dollars pay for that. I'm not fucking Christian. Like, that seems a little bit weird, but there's that very big, like, freedom of everything until you're doing something that I disagree with. Like, you have freedom over everything. It's beautiful. You're an American, but you want to do marijuana? Like, fuck no, dude. Like, that's really bad. You know, I say as I chug a beer and smoke a cigarette, like, okay, that seems a little hypocritical, but...
Right. I think that there's a lot of hypocrisy on both sides of the political spectrum, which is mostly why I don't like to subscribe to either one.
Yeah.
I am politically unaffiliated. But this last election was such a shit show. What do you think of Tommy Lahren getting suspended from the Blaze? Did you already talk about that today?
No, I haven't. Honestly, it kind of surprises me. So typically, to not get too sidetracked, one of the worst things that's happened on the internet is it's given you the ability to find anybody that agrees with you. That's like the worst thing ever. You know, back when we were growing up, you know, and even more so you than me, because, you know, I'm 10 years younger than you, like, to some extent you had to put up with the people around you. Like, if you didn't like them or they had severely opposing points of view, like, that's it, dude. You know, I mean, back in the early days you're like IRC channels and shit, but like, for the most part, you couldn't go and find any type of community you wanted. But today, no matter what belief I have, whether I think the earth is fucking flat or, you know, phrenology is a real science, like, I can go and find a community on the internet that I can exclusively talk to and circle jerk my beliefs about. So that being said, I listen to a lot of conservative media almost exclusively because I like to hear what people I disagree with say. And I listen to a lot of Glenn Beck, and there is very interesting things. I don't know. Do you follow conservative media a lot?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I listen to Hannity, Beck. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, God. Yeah. Hannity. Fuck. It's hard. I don't know if you're conservative or liberal or which side of the political spectrum do you fall on? Do you consider yourself?
Neither. I consider myself politically ambivalent, although it depends on the year. Some people think I'm a huge Hillary supporter. Some people think I'm a huge Trump supporter. I piss off both sides. I would say that socially, I'm probably a little bit more left-leaning, though in recent years, probably fiscally a little bit more conservative. And I absolutely do not consider myself a libertarian. But anyway, go on. Yeah, go on.
Well, those are the two easiest ways to identify someone as an asshole. If they call themselves libertarian or a classical liberal, it's like my two easy. Like, okay, well, you're probably a fucking dick. Gotcha, dude. Glenn Beck has actually been like, I disagree with almost every fucking thing this dude says. I used to worship him in high school, but I disagree with everything he says now. But he's principled as fuck. Glenn Beck is very principled. He's very consistent. Yeah. He almost tanked the Blaze, like, in a lot of ways in his own media program because he did not buy into Trump. He didn't like Trump, and he doesn't like Trump, and he continues to speak out against him. And I thought that was very admirable because all the other big dudes, Hannity, Rush Limbaugh, you know, have all jumped on the fucking Billy Cunningham, have all jumped onto the big Trump train. So I thought that was kind of cool. It surprised me that Tommy Lahren got suspended because when I listened to her comments on The View, she gave what I perceived to be as the classical libertarian answer to abortion, which was, I don't want the federal government regulating it, right? That's kind of like the classical libertarian answer. You don't want the government legislating morality, right? So it seems strange to me that Glenn Beck was so opposed to that. Now, I know that Glenn Beck is a Mormon, and I know that his religion is very important to him. He does a whole history series on how the United States is a Christian nation and whatnot. So I don't know if a lot of that plays into it there, but... Yeah, I was pretty surprised about that.
Yeah, I will take a principled idiot any day over an unprincipled smart guy or somebody who is who is malicious or chaotic in that sense. I have been watching Glenn Beck over the years, and I thought he was devolving into Alex Jones territory for a while with the chalkboards and all that shit.
He's
when he was still on CNN.
Yeah, he's kind of getting there. Yeah,
he's getting back over there now.
Well, like, he kind of has like this. It feels like there's kind of like an alternate Beck reality sometimes, but he's not quite into Alex Jones. I don't know if anyone's in Alex Jones, Terry. I guess everybody to some extent does it. Political commentators, this is one of the reasons why I got into politics a lot, is because I noticed that, like, what political commentators do is they frame this world. They have this paradigm of viewing things where every single action of your political adversary can be explained through some type of... some type of political narrative. Let me give you an example. Rush Limbaugh, right? Let's say that you have a Democrat pass a legislation to increase, you know, welfare availability, whatever, right? if this happens, right? So a left-leaning person might say, a very biased left-leaning person might say, this is an awesome action. You know, the Democrats are trying to save all the poor people, and this is the best thing ever in Obama's liturgies, right? A politically neutral person might say, like, okay, well, the Democrats are passing legislation that hopefully they think is going to help people, you know, in a disadvantaged position. You know, hopefully we'll see how it works out, if the incentives are right, if the policy is right. And then somebody on Rush Limbaugh's side will say, okay, well, the Democrats have launched this new piece of legislation, and their ultimate aim is to get poor people dependent on the government so that they can foster a future viewer or a future voter base for generations to come, right? Like, every single thing your political opponent does can be explained through these ulterior motives and conspiracies. And it sets, it puts people in these worlds where it, like, it blows my fucking mind. Like, oh, fuck, my mom is upstairs. I love her so much. But, like, let me give you an example. I remember growing up, my mom cried to me when Bill Clinton was not, like, completely impeached, right? My mom was in the Air Force, and she was talking to me about how, like, it's horrible that, you know, I'm in the Air Force, and from the top down, the commander-in-chief has this degrading view of women, and I have to put up with that every single day at work, right? And it's like, okay, yeah, I understand that. And she was very, very emotional. Explain this to me. And today, you know, she defends Trump's comments about grab him by the pussy. And it's like, how can you do this, right? Unless you are so taken in by your political narrative that the enemy is always the opposition and your allies are always the good guys, you know? And then to explain away anything else, you can no true Scotsman fallacy away everything else, right? So say a Republican does something bad. Well, that wasn't really bad. Say a Republican does something that was really bad. Oh, well, he's not really a Republican. He's a rhino, right? It's like, oh, so there's no way to get you, right?
Yeah, you can't nail anything to them. You can't pin anything to them. Look, if you cannot criticize your guy, you're biased.
Yeah.
You're biased as shit. You need to take a step back and you need to reflect. You need to look at your life. You need to analyze your political point of view. You need to realize that, look, if you are supporting a bad person, the problem is that nobody ever thinks they're the bad guy. Yeah. Nobody ever thinks that they made a mistake. They always, I mean, because essentially the crux of this all comes down to one essential principle, which is most people, and I truly believe this, I think most people have good intentions. And if you start to look at politics from that prism, all right, assume that the left has good intentions and assume that the right has good intentions, because ultimately we are all Americans and we want what's best for this country. We want what's best for our fellow man. We all identify with each other. We all have families. We all have kids. We all have mouths to feed, right? We all want what's best for everyone else. The only difference is how we approach towards solving that problem. And that minor philosophical difference seems to be dividing us more and more. And I think at the behest of Facebook and social media, which I think has accelerated the acrimony, the hatred and the division in this country.
Because it lets people set up those same echo chambers even harder, yeah. There used to be, I remember a quote, I grew up very Catholic. I went to Catholic school for 12 years of my life. I went to a Jesuit high school, and then I became one of the edgy New Age atheists, right? The Richard Dawkins, Christopher Hitchens kind of guy. Very, very, very edgy. I remember one of the quotes I read back then, you know, was, you know, always reaffirm my edgy atheist beliefs, is like a good person will act good, a bad person will act bad, but for a good person to act bad, that takes religion. Well, it also can happen via politics. Like, fuck. Like, I very much agree with what you're saying. Like, I think that when Republicans talk about cutting taxes, you know, to businesses, you know, as part of their trickle down, you know, idiocy, I think that their hearts are in the right place. You know, I think that they probably do think that is the best way to grow their economy. I would hope the average person, you know, and same thing on the left when they're, you know, I don't want anybody that has an R next to their name ever speaking at my school. I want to hope that, you know, they think that they're doing a good thing by protecting people from really offensive stuff and making most people good people. Like, yeah, I agree with that, that both sides are hopefully well-intentioned. If not the leaders, at least the followers, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, well, when it comes to oh, shit, I just lost my train of thought. So it all comes down to being able to criticize yourself and criticize your guy. Mm-hmm. And if you're not able to, then you just fall into the trap of demagoguery. It's my guy, right or wrong. It's my sports team. It's like fans of who's a really shitty NFL team, the Lions. I mean, sure. I don't know anything. Yeah, I don't know anything about sports. But like, if I was into sports and my team kept losing over and over and over again, I'd be like, okay, you know what? I'm out. I'm bailing. This team sucks. That's not.
Oh,
what's...
so you're a bandwagoner.
Yeah, I'm a total bandwagoner. I'm absolutely a bandwagon. Yeah, why wouldn't I be? And you know, oh, here's what I want to talk to you about too. I want to get your opinion on this. What do you think of the criticism virtue signaling? What do you think of that?
There is a lot of Anytime I see somebody say it, I like start to ignore everything they say.
Yeah.
I think that it probably exists. There are a lot of tactics that people use. Okay, hold on. I'm just writing something down so I can remember. A lot of tactics that people use to immediately discredit or immediately signal like certain things. So like when you start saying things like, so say you're talking about a very offensive word, right? I don't think that, you know, like, here are my arguments for why I don't think you should be able to use this word in this circumstance. I think that's offensive, blah, 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 blah. And somebody's like, oh, so you're PC. You're PC, huh? You want to just be PC? Like, okay, dude, like, what, this is how you shut down all, right? People on the left will do it. Well, where, say, somebody on the right will say something like, I think the welfare state is destroying black families. I think that, you know, the incentives that we have in place right now are contributing to this culture of violence or whatever, blah, 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 right? And whether you're right or wrong, like, these are okay arguments, right? You can defend these positions.
Sure,
and somebody's
sure.
like, oh, so you're racist, right? It's like, well, okay. Okay, so I mean, I guess I don't get to talk about anything because you don't like, you know? Yeah, wait, what was the original thing?
The virtue signaling.
Oh,
what
yeah,
do you
virtue
think of that?
Signaling
yeah.
is like mm-hmm. one of those things that I hear called out. Like, I hear that in kind of the same way where you say something like, I think that the United States needs to do something to help, you know, disadvantaged families or, you know, this. And people are like, oh, so you're virtue signaling. It's like, well,
virtue
no. Okay, like, I don't know what that means, but okay. Like, yeah.
Well, the reason I ask is because I've been thinking about that phrase a lot lately. Mm-hmm. I've been thinking about, because I get called every now and then. It's so stupid. I get people on the left criticizing me for being a Trump supporter, which I'm not. I hate Trump. And mm-hmm. then I get people on the right criticizing me for virtue signaling and being a cuck. But I've been thinking about this phrase, virtue signal, and what does it mean and how is it an insult?
So I think
if you. Yeah.
I think virtue signaling can be a very legitimate insult, but people just don't use it. Same thing with PC or racist. These are all legitimate things, but people overuse them. Like, when I think virtue signaling is somebody that talks about a certain moral thing, but they may or may not actually believe it, but they just kind of talk about it to sound good, to earn social capital, right? And then
sure.
this kind of thing is doubly bad when they go back on it in the future. I wish I could think of some left-leaning examples, but a really easy right-leaning example is Republicans talking about abortion. This has happened time and time again where Republicans talk about the evils of abortion and how horrible it is, and then they fucking get their mistress or some shit pregnant, and then she takes a trip to Planned Parenthood to get rid of the baby, and it's like, okay, so you don't actually believe in any of this shit, or anybody, right? I don't know if you're familiar with the argument, the only moral abortion is my abortion, right? Where you'll have a person that's been, you know, pro-life, anti-abortion their entire life, they definitely hate abortion, it's really bad, and as soon as they're in a situation to use it, they're like, well, fuck, I need to do it. I have all these reasons. Like, you know, it's really necessary this time, but not for anybody else. Like, okay, so you were kind of virtue signaling. Like, you didn't really believe this. You're a massive hypocrite. Like, I think it can be used to some extent, but people overuse the fuck out of it.
I agree. Okay, so the example that you just gave is mm-hmm. perfect. That is a great example of true virtue signaling. And in that sense, it's basically it's essentially the same thing as calling somebody a hypocrite.
Sure.
But a little bit more nuanced, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the way that people are calling me a virtue signaler or someone on the left or somebody like anybody who says something like, you know, we should it's the what Trump said, grab him by the pussy is bad, which I honestly think that's the least of the worst thing that he said in that clip,
yeah.
because that is such a headline grabber that you forget what he said just 5 seconds prior, which was he's trying to have sex with a married woman.
Well, but keep in mind that the people that support him are oftentimes red-pilled or MGTOW or pickup artist people, so that's not even a bad thing to them. So it's like...
Oh, man. I just learned about MGTOW, and it's so funny.
The farther right... you like, if you ever want to get into, like, you're a guy and you think feminism is stupid as fuck, and you're like, okay, I want to get into some of these. So you start with the MRAs, right? The men's rights
yeah.
activists,
yeah.
right? Which, for the most part, is probably okay, right? They advocate for certain men's rights issues, which is cool, right? I don't think
sure.
that's fine. Some of them get a little bit crazy, and some of them get very fucking crazy, and then you venture a little bit farther, and then you find like the red pill community, who have
yeah.
been opened, awakened to the worlds of how evil women are and how they try to manipulate everything. Then you go a little bit further, and you find the pickup artists, and these are the guys that have taken these are like pickup artists are like the engineers to the physicists. They're like applied red pill, right? Like they are using
right.
red pill application in order to pick up women and manipulate them, right? And then you go even farther down the spectrum and you get MGTOW, who are like, we have evolved beyond needing women because we realize how horrible they are. It just gets like more, and then further down the line you get the Thulean perspective dude who even says the MGTOW people don't go far enough. Like, yeah, no, it's
wow.
pretty funny. Yeah, that
wait,
whole...
what's past MGTOW?
There's some guy on YouTube called Thulean Perspective who is
uh-huh.
just pretty insane, but yeah.
So for those, I'm reading in the chat room, some people are asking what MGTOW is. It's men going their own way. And what that means is basically men who've sworn off women, and they think that they can live without women. They don't need women anymore.
Yep, that's pretty funny.
I mean, the next evolution down that path, I think, is artificial wombs for men, so men can give birth and get pregnant.
I feel like there's got to be like a skit in there somewhere where maybe Key and Peele or somebody could do the thing where like two guys are, you know, like they've like discovered like the perfect relationship is like the homosexual male relationship because you don't have to deal with women, you know, and it's like there's some ironic future where, you know, child homelessness is solved and there are no more adoption clinics because all the kids have been adopted because all the men have decided to go their own way and have gay relationships and everything. And yeah, they figured it all out.
Yeah, I definitely think that that some people believe that. Even today, I've met some people who believe that. But I should mention that I know Neil Strauss. He is the author of The Game, which is like the book, the original book for pickup artists. Have you read it?
I have not. I'm familiar with a lot of PUA ideology, though, so I'm sure I know some of the concepts or whatever.
Yeah, it's a very interesting read. And for those in the chat room who don't have time, and you especially because you're so busy, but if you don't have time to read it, I think Neil Strauss was once essentially said that if you want to be better, if you want to become a pickup artist, you can read the book and learn all the strategies and all that shit, or you can just take an improv class and, you know, groom a little bit. And that's essentially what it comes down to, is being confident and interesting. That's it.
Yeah, the biggest problem about the pickup artist and Red Pill community is that the reason why it's so powerful is because a lot of it, it's like they find nuggets of truth, but then they go full insanity with it, you know? Like, like women like confident men. Like, yeah, that's absolutely true. And then they're like, so you need to tell a woman that she's a piece of shit a million times to neg her down. To it's like, what happened? No, why can't you just be, right? Or it's like, yeah, it's like, Jesus Christ. You're like, you know, like there's like all these tricks and shit. It's like, in order, like, make sure that you, you know, stare at her eye for 7 seconds, not 6 seconds, because then it's not enough to let her know you're interested, but 8 is too long and you appear needy and desperate. It's like, why? Like, there are basic truths here, like be confident, you know, look at people when you talk to them and be interesting, be interested in the person you're talking to. But like, God, absolutely, they take it so fucking far to like the logical extremes, or not even logical extremes, but like to the most extreme positions. Like, Jesus.
The insane extremes.
Yeah.
The absurd extremes. I'll just tell you my personal opinion on, because we kind of touched on it, is the Red Pill MRA community and feminism. I think that they are two sides of the same coin today. And now when people criticize, when they say, oh, hey, Maddox, how come you're not a feminist? You know, I tell them, like, look, guy or girl, I am in favor of equality. Of course, everybody is. And the 70s, the first wave feminism, which is total egalitarianism, I think everybody's on board with that. But modern feminism, I think, has been warped and bastardized and become this toxic thing. And I think the men's rights movement, for the same reasons, they're two extremes and they're annoying each other in the exact same way. I'm glad they both exist together, but I think they're both equally annoying. Where do you stand on that?
Yeah, I mean, this all comes down to like how you define terms, pretty much. Like, somebody can ask you, like, are you a feminist? And you can say yes, and that can mean very different things to very different people, you know? Like, you know, like, yeah, you know, I think that women should have equal opportunity in the United States. I don't necessarily disagree with, you know, certain types of programs to, you know, move them up, or, you know, to encourage them to move into different sectors of the economy or education. You know, but I don't believe that. Like, are you familiar with like Anita Sarkeesian or Zoe Quinn or Randy Harper?
Yeah, yeah. I met Anita Sarkeesian not too long ago at E3.
Yeah.
What is it? What is that exasperated sigh? I want to hear what you have to say.
She's somebody that I would consider falls a little bit too extreme onto one side of things. Where like somebody like that views their paradigm, right? We were talking about political paradigms before. Her paradigm is feminism, and she views everything through that lens, right? It's very irritating that they'll hijack other issues in the name of feminism, right? So, for instance, like she had a lot to say about different shootings, mass shootings that happen in the United States. She's like, well, all of these shootings happens because of toxic, you know, patriarchy, you know, and stuff like that. And it's like, okay, like every single thing can't be because of the patriarchy, right? There are other issues, you know, to talk about. You know, you've got mental health, you've got access to guns in the United States. There's a lot of other issues that you could take issue with. You can't look at the patriarchy as like being every single source of, or the source of every single problem, you know? Like,
yeah, it's the start and the end of the problems. I think where they're losing people, and I thought this was really interesting. I read in a survey in Huffington Post. Again, I think Huffington Post is very left-leaning, and they are very pro-feminist. They have a women's portal on their website. They did a survey. I think they did a survey, or they published a survey by Pew Research, where they found that only 24% of women identify as feminists. Mm-hmm. And you would think by the amount that we hear about it, Especially today in today's culture, you hear that Trump is kind of like the response, it's kind of the backlash to gender politics and SJWs and the whole movement online, yeah. Right? Have you heard that argument being made?
Yeah, of course. This is the encapsulated in the single statement. This is why Trump won. Yeah,
exactly. That's
every
a great way to
put it. Every time you make
it.
A reasonable argument about anything, like, hey, like maybe it's not fair. This is why Trump won. Like, okay, dude, fuck you. Yeah,
exactly. This is why Trump won. Okay, so let's just entertain that notion, okay? That Trump won because of the backlash to the SJWs, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that that's going to make the SJWs louder or quieter? Because it's not going to make them quieter. They're, everybody's complaining now. And if you don't like the SJWs, if you thought that it was bad before, wait till you see this shit, because it's taking off. The train has way more momentum today than it ever did.
If you think
that Trump is a response to SJWs, guess what's coming as a response to Trump, idiot? I don't want the liberal version of Trump. I don't want if you can even call Trump a conservative. I don't even know what he is.
Sure. Yeah, no, I know what you mean. Yeah, the extremism on both sides is really bad. One kind of tying into what you said, one of the biggest problems, and I've noticed this, and I've done so many of these conversations with people at this point, that it's really hard to get people to agree on what is reality. And like, if you know what somebody's reality is, you can start to guess all of their political views at that point, depending on what version of reality they subscribe to. You know, it's sure. If you're a person who thinks that the United States is doing well and there are absolutely no problems here, then you're probably, you know, a left-leaning liberal that, you know, wanted to keep America great. Like Hillary said, if you're somebody that subscribes to the beliefs that every single thing in the United States is failing and fucking horrible and ISIS is literally like setting up camp in Mexico right now about to march over the border, you're probably right-leaning, you know, ready to go down and put up the wall. Like, it seems like people have these massive like reality gaps where they just live in these totally different worlds sometimes.
Yeah, it's and it's always a huge problem up until it comes to the point where you have to put boots on the ground and enlist. Yeah. And then a lot of people shy away. Not all of them, to be fair. You know, the people who do serve, you know, they put their money where their mouth is, unless it's just for college or whatever, because I don't think anybody really enlists with the hope of going to war, except for a few sociopaths.
Sure.
Yeah. By the way, how are you doing on time? I know your mom's in town. Do you have to spend some time with your mom?
Oh, no, she's been here for a few weeks. I usually stay awake pretty late. Yeah.
Okay, so you were saying?
Oh, I was going to say, what would you call somebody who talked a lot about the virtues of war, but then ducked out of the draft or anything?
Kind of like
virtue signaling a little bit.
It is virtue signaling. That's exactly what it is. Now, that is virtue signaling in the definition that you gave earlier, which is the hypocritical type. Like, you're signaling a virtue you don't actually believe in. But here's the virtue signaling that I get, that I see happening way more often than that online, which is anytime somebody says something like, oh, this position is wrong, you know, of course, all lives matter, but Black lives matter too, which is the whole reason we have that slogan, right?
Yeah.
And then
Blue
lives matter, exactly. And then they criticize them as saying that they're virtue signaling. I think, well, when I get criticized as being as virtue signaling, I think the only way that that's an insult to me is that I'm being immodest. All right, I am virtuous, and I am bragging about how virtuous I am. And I thought, well, yeah. Of course, no shit. Why the hell wouldn't I be? I am virtuous. I'm not that. You know, I'm not that guy. I'm not that kind of guy. One of the things that pisses me off is when I see a news interview with a guy who just ran into a building and saved someone from a burning building, right? Or he jumped on top of him and the train was passing, or you saved someone from some dangerous situation. And then during the interview, inevitably, the news reporter says, "Do you consider yourself a hero?" And they say, "Oh no, I'm not a hero. I'm just doing what anyone would have done." It's like, no, fuck you. You're a hero. Own it. Why do we have to pretend to be modest in society? If that happened to me, if I did something heroic, I'd go on the news. I'd go on a fucking tour telling people how heroic I am. I am constantly virtue signaling.
Sure. It's a little bit different, to be fair, in our positions because, I mean, signaling to others our beliefs is part of our platforms, right? We're constantly trying to get fans and whatnot. So maybe people view it a little bit, right? I mean, I'll admit, like, right, even in talking to you, right, being totally honest, like, everything that I do, it to some extent, you know, plays into my perception as a public figure, the amount of people that are, you know, cognizant of my existence and whatnot. So, yeah. But, so, I mean, yeah, I guess if you take it in that way, it's like, are you a virtue signal? Yeah, I want to signal, you know, my virtues to as many people as possible. One, to ensure that they share my virtues, and then two, to pick up new fucking fans. Sure.
Yeah, so I'm kind of curious, actually. So speaking of your fans and your fan base and your stream, you've been doing this for a while. What was the precipitous moment for you that really put it on the map, like just blew you up to the next level?
It's kind of different for me than most people. I was one of the, if not the first person to do the streaming as a full-time job. I actually started this 7 years ago, I think. For me, it was, I'm a very, very cold, like super rational person when it comes to everything. I'm not like a big, like follow your dreams too. Like I'm very, very rational. And basically what happened was, skip a lot of stuff. Basically, I was streaming on a certain platform. They started paying people. I got my first paycheck from them. I want to say it was like $205 or something. And I noticed that at the time I was working my normal job as a carpet cleaner, which is one of the worst fucking jobs in the world, like fucking 90 hours a week, shit pay, doing water damage, restoration, whatnot, like a lot of just really shitty work. And I noticed that, like, dude, I'm dumping like 70, 80 hours a week into this fucking bullshit. And I stream, you know, my free time when I get home and I made $200 there. I was like, well, if I do this full time, right, I'll make more money or at least the same as I do this carpet cleaning shit. So then I quit my carpet cleaning job and then I started streaming full time. And then I've kind of just had like slow and steady growth since then, pretty much for the most part, a couple hiccups in between.
Do you ever become friends in real life with some of your fans or listeners?
Kind of, yeah. I'm very, part of the way that I built my, you know, how I built my brand and my community and whatnot is I'm very personable. Like I talk to I have like my own community. I know a lot of the names that I see in my community. Like I know a lot of what they talk about, you know, and I have relatively personal relationships with a lot of them. Like my admin team are all people from my community. The guy that made my website and my chat are all people from my community. People that I play games with oftentimes are from my community. And then I meet up with them, you know, at like events sometimes, you know, whether it's to go out to eat or hang out or, you know, sign things from fans or hang out at events. So and then, you know, obviously some of them become longer term friends that I talk to, you know, on Skype or pull in for different games and whatnot as well. So
that's really cool. I'm always curious to hear that and glad to hear that, because I feel like it's kind of a small world when you get to the level of the stuff that we're doing here. Mm-hmm. It's very weird. I still can't explain it to my parents. My mom's constantly canvassing for me to get a real job and go back to school. Yeah, she just doesn't get it. But yeah, I'd say I've made a lot of friends in real life. Mm-hmm. Just with fans, people who start out as fans.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and the people that you tap in your community, like, you find a lot of amazing fucking people, too. Like, you'd think, like, you know, you tell somebody what you do, like, oh, you know, yeah, a bunch of, you know, 14, 15-year-olds watch me at home. I'm like, yeah, sure. But, you know, like, I've got, like, a guy that I talk to the time who's a lawyer that I bring on to talk about, you know, relevant issues, legal issues and whatnot that I can always tap to. You know, I've got people that are really talented devs. My whole website and everything, you know, has been built by fans, you know, running servers and shit. Like, there's a lot of talented people. And I'm sure it's the same in your audience, too, where you've got, like, a lot of very intelligent, very talented people. The guy that I take advice from for credit cards was like, a multimillionaire by the time he was 30, so he gives me a lot of information. When I'm like, yeah, there's a lot of really, really sick people that you would never imagine that you would come across in this line of work that you have the opportunity to meet and talk to.
Yeah, when I wrote my first book, The Alphabet of Manliness, I put out a call for illustrators, and I got, I think, over a half a gig of submissions in under a week, just thousands and thousands of emails from people, and I was getting stuff from Pixar. People from Pixar were emailing me and saying, hey, Maddox, we're big fans of yours. We'd love to work on your book. And I was blown away and flattered. I'm like, guys, you're amazing, but you're way out of my pay grade. Not for the budget they gave me to write a book. By the way, is that something that ever interests you? Would you ever want to write a book?
My views, I am a very different person now than I was 4 or 5 years ago. My views and everything have changed so much. And I keep finding that, I don't know at the stage you are in your life, if it's the same for you, or maybe that changes as you get older. But like every 2 years I look back and I'm constantly thinking like, what the fuck was I thinking when I said that? Like, oh my God, why was I so stupid? So like, I'm always nervous. Like, I don't want to put anything that I think right now into permanent writing, because I don't know if in 2 years I'm going to think like, what the fuck was I thinking? You know? So, I mean,
look, man, you're allowed to change your opinion. You're allowed to change your mind. And the beauty of writing a book is you have an editor who will make sure that, you know, as much as they can, that what you put on the page and gets to print is good and represents you effectively, if you have a good editor.
Sure. Yeah, maybe so I wouldn't at worry some about point. That. I haven't really thought about it much now because there's so many other things that I kind of have my fingers in, but yeah.
Yeah. So what's next for you? What are you working on next?
I'm not even sure. There's like, I'm kind of drawn in two big directions right now. I'm a video game streamer. It's what I've made my life doing. And it's what I continue to do. And I enjoy it. I like playing games and shit. Like, fuck, dude, who wouldn't want to play video games all day? The political stuff draws me, you know, like really hard. I am very interested in political things. I think it's really hard to find voices of reason on YouTube. It really disappoints me that there is no person that I can listen to and feel like they're, you know, saying all the time, like, people on the right are fucking crazy. People on the left sometimes are cool, but, like, I don't know how you feel about – remember when that Richard Spencer dude got punched in the street?
Yes.
When you have a bunch of minorities, a bunch of black people and women who are getting online saying, like, yeah, it's really good that we punch people that we disagree with. It's like, do you really want to take that stance against a bunch of fucking rednecks with guns? Like, you really want to make all of this violent and shit? Like, do you think that's the best way to go forward with, like, not to mention the fact that, like, you guys call every single person that disagrees with you a fucking Nazi. I don't think I want to get, like, I've been called a fucking Nazi, dude. Like, I don't want to get punched in the street because some dude is going to ascribe some belief to me that I don't, like, so it's like, it's really hard to find people. I had a person send me DMs today that in my conversation with Sargon, like, if I was truly believing, like, in the person of color cause and minority issues, that I should be citing more statistics from exclusive person of color resources. And it's like, the fuck are you talking about, dude? Like, I'm not going to do this shit. Like, I'm going to, you know, avoid the whole Bureau of Justice statistics and the FBI database because it's not a person of color approved statistic database. Like, the fuck, dude? Like, come on. Yeah, so, like, having that voice, I think, is really nice. I've had a lot of people tell me that they like it, you know, jerk myself off or whatever. So I don't know if I'll try to get more involved in that. I've kind of wanted to get into, like, the podcast realm, but it's so much time. I mean, obviously you have
it, 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 yeah.
right? Find, doing the
it really is
finding people to talk to, getting the topics listed right. and everything, and, like, yeah.
Well, dude, we'd love to have you on. I have a podcast. It's called The Best Debate. This isn't a plug, I swear to God. It's called The Best Debate in the Universe. And the reason I mention it is because we just debated the Richard Spencer thing, whether or not it's okay to punch a Nazi. And I originally pitched that topic as just something fun to talk about, like, oh, is it okay to kick a Nazi? Is it okay to curb stomp it? Like, all these crazy things, right?
Sure.
Then it accidentally turned out to be a very thoughtful debate. I'd be curious to see what you think about it. And so it sounds like you fall on the side where it's not okay to punch a Nazi, right?
No, I just – the problem is that I just don't think that – like, again, fuck, dude, I grew up so patriotic, and even though I'm left-leaning today and I've abandoned, you know, most of my jerking off America is the best place ever, like, there are still, like, there are core American beliefs that I, you know, subscribe to, and one of those is freedom of speech, and I really don't like the idea of using violence as a means of silencing people in the street. I don't like that. Similar to, like, the SJW stuff where, like, we boycott people from going onto college campuses and talking because we don't like what they have to say. Like, I don't like that kind of stuff either. Like, that really bothers me. Just because I was kind of giving examples earlier, like, if you follow that, you open up, like, this can of worms into so much bad shit, right? Like, so you're now able to decide that anybody that says something that you think is sufficiently abhorrent has now warranted violence. Well, what's to keep anybody from the right from attacking somebody that gets up and talks about Muslim issues? Maybe you've got a woman who thinks they should be able to wear the hijab, or even that women should be forced to wear it. Can you go and use violence against them, right? Like, where does this stop? Like, I don't want people scared to say to speak their mind on the streets because somebody's going to walk up and, you know, like, beat the shit out of them for it, you know?
Well, so, okay, this is such a huge loaded topic, and we essentially went down this path on the show too, which is, like, yeah, someone might say, okay, well, if we're punching Nazis, can we punch Muslims? Can we punch communists? Like, these are, you know, different groups that have maybe led to deaths and violence and genocide. But I think Nazis are unique in that they have actually led to genocide. And then there's the debate on whether or not Richard Spencer is truly a Nazi. First of all, do you think he is?
I don't know what the fuck any of these people are anymore. It's hard to say. I mean, dude, like, I'll talk to some dude who is literally telling me about the three different types of human skull shapes and that black people are more athletic but not as intelligent as white people. And they will say, like, well, I wouldn't consider myself a racist. It's like, fuck, dude, I don't know, dude. Like, I guess, like, maybe I'm a little bit too idealistic, but these are people that have very minor views in society, and I would hope that society continues to progress in the ways that it has, right? I think most of us can agree that we've moved in good directions culturally over the past 200, 300, 400 years, and as long as these guys continue to be minority thoughts, and as long as we continue to protect core American values, like ensuring freedom for everybody and whatnot, that these wouldn't become, like, prevailing thought or have, like, bad, you know, influence. Like, even if I defend, like, a Nazi's right to speak on a corner, I don't defend his right to go out and, like, murder a Jewish person or murder a minority or whatever, you know.
Okay, so I want to pitch this to you. I want, because you seem like a very reasonable, rational man. I'm not blowing sunshine up your ass, but I want to see what you think about this, because Nazism, like fascism, isn't something that is just a conversation that happens on the street in passing and you just ignore it and you shrug your shoulders and go away. It's kind of just like a snowball. And it, as that snowball grows bigger and bigger, the argument has been made like, oh, well, once it gets big enough, if people are threatening violence and fascism, that's when you start to deal with it with violence. Mm-hmm. But what I'm afraid might happen, and because we've seen this happen before, what I'm afraid might happen is it gets a critical mass where it becomes big enough that, yeah, it looks like it's going to become violent, but it's so big that you can't do anything about it because they will quash you and they will kill you. So it just becomes this out of control thing. So how do you prevent that from ever happening, where it very gradually and very subtly becomes a fascist regime?
I mean, again, this is really heavy. You get into a lot of different topics there. I guess if some sort of prevailing thought, hold on, there's two different... Just writing down my thoughts, don't forget. So there's like two different ways to think about this. Firstly, if it does become a really big thing and it sweeps the nation, it sounds bad to say, but who are you to stop that prevailing thought then? If a lot of people buy into it, and that's the way that people are, you know, persuaded to move, who are you as some kind of arbitrator of value to tell these people that they're not allowed to be neo-Nazis? And kind of on a way to kind of test the consistency of that argument, all of the same arguments that you're making right now, right? So you're saying, so like right now, Nazism isn't a problem, but it advocates for, you know, these really bad things like violent activity, right? It's advocating for violence against groups of people. If it gets big enough, okay, well, now you want to stop it. Well, you can't, because now way too many people buy into it. Look, you now you have to, you know, sleep in the bed you've made or whatever, right? Now you fucked yourself. That same argument could be applied to every single social movement, right? You could apply that to civil rights, right? Like, we need to quash this people protesting in favor of, you know, black people rights now, because this is going to lead to the destruction of the economy in the South. All of our agriculture is going to be fucked. You know, we're going to have to, you know, bring all these black people into society that are, you know, are here only as objects and as slaves. It's not going to be fair. You know, even people in the North could argue against it, because, you know, now people in the South get way more fucking votes or whatever, right? The three-fifths bullshit to try to limit the amount of votes you would get as a slave owner. Like, it's just like all these bad things that could happen. So to keep us from ever heading this route, we're just going to use violence to shut these people up immediately. We're always going to kill people that disagree with our ideology so that it doesn't, right? I feel like I just don't know who is, like, all of these questions, I feel like you take for granted that you are the moral arbitrator there, right? But if somebody else were to be the moral arbitrator, would you trust their decision on what ideologies should you allow to survive, you know, in the streets?
Well, it depends on the person and whether or not they have a good heart.
Yeah, but I mean, like, there are racists with good hearts, right? I think my grandma was probably a good person, but she said very bad thing, right? But that's just because that's just the time they grew up in, right? Same thing with my parents. I don't think my parents are that excited about gay rights. I think they're good people, but they, in the time period that they grew up in, right? So I guess my question that I would pose back to you, like, with that example and that kind of thing, is like, who decides, you know, what thoughts should be allowed to survive? Like, who decides what's allowed and what's not allowed?
Well, that's an interesting question. That's a really big one. And first of all, I got to say, that's a good argument that you had, although I feel like it doesn't address the fact that we have a precedent with Nazis in particular. We do have a precedent of a genocide with them. But then to answer your question about who decides what, you know, what we should tolerate, what views and what ideas we should tolerate. Now, this is going to seem like a silly, absurd question, but I'm going to ask you in earnest. Are you in favor of democracy? Do you think that democracy is a good thing?
Dude, you're asking me this question in a post-Brexit world and in a post-Trump world. Like,
Exactly. That's my point. So I used to be one of these people that thought, democracy. Yeah, democracy is number one. Of course, it's the foundation. It's the bedrock of America, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I believe that anymore. I don't know that I think that democracy is a good idea and as a blanket political ideology. And it's because I read recently about I think it's Socrates who had this belief that he said, no, democracy is a disaster. He said, if you are commanding a ship and on the ship you're going to steer the ship to avoid danger or whatever, do you want to have a consensus from people like the cook on the ship and the janitor and, you know, the people who have nothing to do with no aeronautical experience, no expertise? Do you want them really weighing in on the decision, the direction the ship should go? Or should it be one or two really well-learned men who are controlling the ship and steering it away from danger because they know what the fuck they're doing? I think I started to believe that more so than democracy is a good idea as a blanket political ideology. I think it's probably better for people to not have absolute democracy. We shouldn't have dumb people being able to vote, which of course is going to open a whole can of worms. But for sure. What do you think of that?
There's not like a reasonable room to talk about it because it's never going to change. But yeah, to some extent, sure. Do you want somebody that thinks that the world is 6,000 years old voting on somebody based on who they think the next Department of Education head is going to be, right? Do you want somebody that thinks that that all climate change is a hoax from China voting on who they think should be in charge of climate control? Do you want people with these crazy mindsets voting for? Yeah, I don't know. It's a really
What if there was there was some kind of a competency test or some kind of literacy test? Because
you know the answer, right? The problem is you get into so much, right? If you start doing literacy tests, right? It sounds bad to say, but being completely factual, right? A lot of minorities are disproportionately losing their representation there, right? The country is moving pretty well, pretty right, pretty quickly. Although education was a big predictor of who voted, but even if it still stayed left, like you would be disenfranchising groups of people that were disproportionately represented there, right? If you do literacy tests, or if you do like a belief test on certain types of sciences, right? You would be disenfranchising a lot of religious people in the United States who maybe don't buy into different types of scientific things. So it, like, all of these ideas are, yeah, that's the problem, right? You can't really find, like, you can't give a single test to give that wouldn't disproportionately disenfranchise a massive group of people, competency tests have a history of being used to disenfranchise Black people, so there's even like that kind of worms as well. Like
what if it was just a very basic catch-all civics test? Like, you need to understand the very core competency, how government works, what's at stake. Otherwise, I mean, what's the point of voting if you don't even understand what you're voting for? There has to be a balance there, right?
Yeah. Even that would show, it sounds bad to say, but that would come across, racial lines like really hard. Because it sounds bad to say, but like, if you're really fucking broke, if you're a single mom, if you're working two or three jobs, like, you probably don't know the difference between the fucking Senate and the House of Representatives, or that you have a state legislature and a federal, like, you probably don't know these things. So like, should this person necessarily lose their right to vote? Or should this, the problem is that pretty much when you start talking about putting restrictions on who can vote, I think you've moved away fundamentally from what a democracy is, right? Because you're starting to say, yeah. Now, that's an interesting question, like whether or not it's a good or bad. But I think it's more, I think that to get to that point, I think that it's better to just ask, like, is democracy good or bad? And then if you say, like, democracy is bad, then that's fine. We can agree on that. Then we can move towards, like, who should actually be allowed to vote, right? That would be, like, an interesting. But I don't think you can be of the mindset that, like, democracy is a good thing and then start restricting access to voting, just because so many things come across from that,
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You should come from the mindset that democracy is a bad thing and then start adding people who you trust to vote. Like the, I don't know, maybe there should be like a republic. But then you have essentially what we have now, which is the representatives who are voting on legislature that we have no control over on a granular level.
The problem is that all of these things, because we're only talking, keep in mind that right now we are only talking about the most pristine, like, perfect implementation. Like, this stuff could lead to a lot of really shitty things. Say we do have a civics requirement in order to vote. You got to take a little test and get at least fucking half the questions or something, right? You have to be able to at least name like the three branches of government, right? Well, what you're going to wind up seeing is there will be some states that inexplicably cut funding to certain schools in certain areas in these classes, right? Where they don't teach this anymore because people will be doing anything they fucking can in order to influence the vote, right? So these things could manifest themselves in like a million different ways. Like, kind of like voter, are you familiar with like the history of voter ID laws in the United States at all?
Yes, yes.
Right. So like,
I've been following it a lot more closely recently,
Are you familiar with like North Carolina's implementation of voter ID?
No, can we get a recap?
So voter ID on paper sounds fine, sure. People need ID to vote. Like, there's nothing wrong with that, right? But, are you saying Black people can't ID, right? Well, in North Carolina, what the state legislature did was they requested voter breakdown data by race, and then they went, like, for instance, absentee ballot voting could happen 14 days before the election. Well, like 70% of black people voted in the first 7 days. So what they did was they shortened the absentee voting to only one week before. Right, yeah, like shit like this. Or there was a multitude of both expired and current federal and state IDs that they would allow you to use at the polls. Well, they went and they took out a lot of the IDs that were all used by majority black people, right? Or and they cut out a lot of polling places and changed a lot of basically, by the time the, I don't remember if this was a Supreme Court or just a federal judge that went through this, but by the time they went through it, they were like, the words they used were minority communities were targeted with surgical precision to make sure that they had less opportunity to vote, right? Or you've got things like in Texas, you know, like the gerrymandering bullshit where they slice up these districts like it's a fucking, like it's a like a van, I don't know, whatever crazy abstract artist you can pick up back
Escher, MC, it's like an MC Escher.
Sure, yeah, yeah, like the craziest districts in order to get these like preference votings. Like you have to keep in mind that anything that you implement is going to be like abused to the nth fucking degree by people that are trying to get their own result.
Yeah, I was so when it came to the voter ID law, when I first heard it, look, I grew up in a conservative town. I grew up in a conservative state in Utah, and Utah's very, very red. And that kind of shaded my prism of reality for a long time. I grew up to a certain age. I think up until I was like 15, 14 years old, I was homophobic. And it wasn't until I started getting exposed to all these ideas that you know, all of that changed. And it was I realized, you know, the error of my ways, and these are stupid thoughts and beliefs. And in that vein, when I heard about voter ID laws, my conservative mind kicked in, which is like, oh, okay, yeah, of course we should have voter ID laws. Of course we should check IDs for people who are voting. It sounds like such a basic fundamental thing. Mm-hmm. Right, it's a no-brainer, right? But then that's when I realized, when I started reading the opposition to it, they said, well, we have voter ID laws. First of all, IDs cost money.
Yeah.
And I thought, well, how much could an ID cost? And then I read up on it. And it turns out pretty significant because they have to have security measures with those IDs. Otherwise, anyone could forge them very easily. You have to have watermarks, and you have to have different features in there. And there has to be some governing body, some place to regulate who gets those IDs and what credentials they have to provide to get them. And that data needs to be stored in a database, and then it needs to be retrieved, and then you have to hire programmers, then you have to hire administrators, you have to have payroll, you have to have all the shit, and you have this huge bureaucracy just for IDs. And then you have to impose a fee onto people who might not be able to pay that fee to then vote, to take part in our most basic bedrock of democracy, which is voting. You're expecting them to pay a certain amount just to be able to exercise their right to vote. It does seem like it is specifically created to disenfranchise, poor and uneducated voters.
Yeah, and the most important part of that is, what is the central question of this, right? Is why do we need these laws? Has there ever in the history of the United States been demonstrated that fraudulent voting is a massive problem? Right?
No.
It hasn't ever, unless you're Trump and you think 3 to 5 million illegals voted in this election. But it hasn't happened. So why are we talking about these laws? To go along with what you were saying, I don't know if you're familiar with this or not, you're talking about wasting a lot of money. Do you remember when several states, right? Here's another no-brainer, maybe to your 14-year-old self. I know it would have been a no-brainer to my 14-year-old self. Should we drug test people on welfare? Well, yeah, of course. You have to drug test to work a job, right? Like, yeah, sure. Have you seen the states that have implemented the drug testing?
Yep.
Yeah,
yep,
and it's like out of like 45,000 people, like 12 of them test positive for marijuana. It's like that was a lot of fucking money wasted on all of this drug testing. And not only is it money wasted, it's fucking dehumanizing as fuck. Like, oh, you hear you're getting a government check, come on in and make sure that you haven't, you know, like smoked the joint or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
And it's that's because
poverty in this country is viewed as a moral failing.
Yes.
They think that it's, oh, you're a drug addict, you're an alcoholic, you're this and that. But that's not the case. And every single one of these states, I think they did it in Florida and I think Georgia and maybe Kansas, where they're like, oh, well, we're going to make sure that none of these welfare queens are on drugs when they get, you know, we're going to make sure they test them before they get their food stamps. And they test them and they find out, no, most of them don't have drugs. You know who does have the drugs? Rich people, idiots, because drugs cost a lot of money. Drugs are expensive. Of course, you can get some poor drugs. You can get some really shitty drugs, whatever. But the people who are that impoverished, generally speaking, are just trying to survive. They're not worrying about their designer drugs. They're not coked out of their minds. Cocaine is a rich person's drug. Sure. Those are the people who have the drugs.
The one thing that I noticed, this was like a moral or not a moral truth, but like an existential truth of people, is there's it's like twofold. One, you always take credit for your personal success, and you always tend to make excuses for failings, and then you reverse it for other people. So like, yep, everything that you've done, you are the island. Like, right? Like, I passed college. I am a fucking whatever. I feel so proud of myself. Right? Never mind the fact that you had a healthy family, a mom and a dad that cared for and loved you, a mom and a dad that maybe even paid for fucking school, right? A good stable household, right? Good friends, like all this shit, right? Forget all of that, right? You did it on your own, right? But then when you see like another person, you know, who's living in a shit situation, right? Who is maybe like the son of like a single crackhead mom who's still working two or three jobs, right? In a shitty neighborhood with a shitty fucking school, with a gym that's got the ceiling caved in because of water, right? This guy is just a lazy fucking piece of shit. Why didn't he work hard like I did? You know, it's like, damn, dude, like, have some fun. I got into an argument with a guy once who did this, and both of his parents, I found this out like 2 hours into the conversation, this guy went as far as to say that a lot of people with medical problems, it was their fault, right? Like, well, a lot of people with cancer smoked and whatnot, right? This guy's, both of his parents were fucking doctors. And I was like, dog, like, oh, you're so lucky. Like, oh my God.
Yeah. You have the best upbringing.
Yeah,
I mean,
in the world.
I had parents. I like one of my my dad, I think, has a high school education. My mom, like, partial high school education. So their ability to help me through school ended pretty much after junior high, and I was on my own. And I saw my friends who had their parents who had college degrees and college education. They had it so much easier than I did. And then I looked at myself and I thought, well, I probably have it a lot easier than people who don't even have parents, or people who have parents less educated than mine. Mm-hmm. So I was very keenly aware of that, you know, of my upbringing and what I have, and not to just assume and I take it for granted. Now, this is disheartening, but have you seen that 60 Minutes? I think it was 60 Minutes or Nova. I think where they did a study where they gave a bunch of people, brought a bunch of a control group into a room to play a game, like a board game, right? And they arbitrarily decided to give some of the people a little head start. They gave them a little bit more cash in the game.
I feel like I've read about this, but go ahead.
Oh, it's fascinating. So they're basically seeing if people who just stumble into wealth or just start out with an advantage feel like they earned or deserved to win at the end of the game. Not only did they feel like they deserved to win and that they felt like they earned it, but they also started exhibiting more selfish traits and behaviors because they had snacks and refreshments, and they ate on average like twice as much as the other people.
Because
they were arbitrarily given a better lot in the game.
Dude, one of the worst things I've ever read in my fucking life. I think it's I want to say it was Trump's daughter that wrote. Have you seen the passage in her book where she talks about like racers?
No, I haven't.
She says that being rich is kind of like when you look at the Olympics, how some of the track racers on the outside of the track start ahead. Well, they're not actually starting ahead. The reason why their line is farther up is because they've got to run a longer way around. Even though I was born rich, I still had a lot of obstacles that I had to go through that put me on a level playing field with everyone else. She's born to a multi-billionaire. And I was like, no way, you really wrote this without an air of self-awareness about you. Like, I can't believe that you would say this.
You know where that came from, too? It had to have been somebody, you know, growing up, she probably questioned herself, right? And then somebody told her that, her parent or a guardian or a nanny, most likely a nanny, who was trying to make her feel better about being rich, being born rich and not feeling like she didn't earn that lot in life, which she didn't. Nobody does. Nobody.
Yeah.
You know, there was that TED Talk, and, you know, TED Talks are hit and miss, but there was this one where it was this girl who was just absolutely gorgeous. She was born essentially a supermodel, and she talked about her lot in life and how she's able to, you know, when she gets pulled over, she gets out of almost every speeding ticket because the cop is taken aback by her beauty, and she gets free food and free coffee. She says she can't remember the last time she paid for coffee, and it's only because she hit the genetic lottery. She didn't earn that. She didn't. She did nothing to attain that lot in life. But then she has it, and she's keenly aware of it. There's a big difference between people who have that self-cognizance and those who don't. And I feel like those who judge the poor so harshly definitely do not.
Yeah, that really fucking bothers me. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Lack of empathy. That's how we're gonna title this debate, this chat. Lack of empathy.
It's funny because like when I look back at my life, and I it's so interesting because like even up till I was like fucking 20, 21, like I was that poor, broke as fuck, like losing my house, pregnant girlfriend, working a shit dead end job with no education, Republican. Like I was the conservative, like doing that carpet cleaning shit, like working until 11 or 12 every fucking night. And I was like very right leaning in all of my views. And only now, you know, that I, you know, make a fuck ton of money and have, you know, like two houses and shit, do I realize like, oh my God, like I was so fucked in life. Like every single thing when you're wealthy is so much better. And it's crazy to me how people can, and I'm glad that I got to be on both sides of it. Like my kid, I wanted my kid to go to a good school. So I just bought another house to get him into the school district, right? Like there are tons of people that live in the other school district that I left that don't have that opportunity, you know? And it sucks. Right. Like I'm laughing at it. Like my kid is going to have opportunities in life. He's going to go to whatever fucking college he wants to go to. Cause I know he will. Cause I'll fucking pay for it. Right. No matter what he wants to do, I will be there to support him. His mom will be there to support him. We'll get to do it. There are kids that from grade one are fucked. Like you're fucked from grade one. And even I was lucky that for all the problems I had growing up, my parents put me in good schools. I was doing fucking algebra in eighth grade, right? Like past like quadratic equation and shit. So I got to go right into fucking high school, you know, starting college algebra and trig and shit. And that was really good for me. Like I was already, by the time I hit high school, like fucking at almost like a college math level. Not because I'm a genius or because I'm super smart, but because my parents could afford to put me in a private school, you know? Like,
right. I mean, the fact that you're aware of that, I mean, it just it's like puts you miles above everyone else. Some people, when I start talking like this, they feel like they've criticized me of demonizing the rich. It's absolutely not the case. I have a lot of rich friends who are I've known a lot of rich people who are good and a lot who are bad. And it all comes down to your virtues and how you know, how you treat other people. There are people who realize they're very keenly aware of their lot in life and how you know, blessed they are and how they've, due to no circumstances of their own, they not only, you know, you not only stumble into bad things, but sometimes you stumble into good. Mm-hmm. And when you stumble into those good things, you're aware of them and you try to treat your fellow man like a human being, like a person. You give them your respect. You give them your full attention. You give them the time of day. You treat them like another human being would. Sure. That's all it comes down to. And it doesn't matter how rich or poor you are. It just depends on how you treat other people.
Yeah. And I try to be careful. Because I take that poor thing and I try to apply that to like other mindsets too, for things that I used to be like really clueless about, so that I try to be a little bit more aware of, so I'm not stepping into like, you know, like crazy potholes and shit. Did you see the movie Get Out?
Not yet. I really need to. I know Jordan Peele, the guy who made it, but I really want to see that. I've heard just amazing things.
Yeah, I think people are overblowing it a little bit. It's not like the best movie, but it's pretty good. It's definitely solid. You're not wasting your time seeing it. I would get like an 8 out of 10. It was a really, really good movie.
Cool.
But it was a very strange experience. It sounds like really weird, but it was a really strange experience because when I went and saw it, dude, there were a fuck ton of black people in the theater, right? You can tell, right? There were a fuck ton of black people in the theater. And when you have like a bunch of people, I guess, like, not to spoil anything, but you got, like, a bunch of black people behind you cheering for, like, the downfall and shit of, like, the white antagonist and shit. That's, like, a very weird feeling. It was, like, a really strange thing. Like, I'd never experienced that before. Like, I don't know. I felt a little bit otherized there. Like, all these black dudes, like, do they see me as, like, being, like, kind of part of this or whatever? Like, I'm not, you know? Like, it was, like, a really weird thing. It didn't, like, super ultra bother me. Like, you know, I went and cried afterwards. But it was kind of, like, one of those things that made me think, like, if you're a person of color or if you're a woman and every single time you go to the theater, your only representation in a movie is like the guy that dies first or the love interest of the main character. Like those things probably wear on you over time, you know? That's one of the things that I noticed doing the streaming thing is that all problems that people face in life that are super serious are always like problems of time, right? Like when you talk about things like depression, like this isn't something that sucks because, you know, for a day or two, like you're really fucking down and blah, blah, blah. This is something that sucks because it's perpetual, right? And it impacts every part of your life for days and days and weeks and months and for years, right? Or when I was really fucking poor, like being poor doesn't suck because you can't get the new PC, you know, thing, the new graphics cards or whatever. It sucks because you deal with it like every single day and it influences every single decision you make. Like every time you go out to eat, every time you want to hang out with friends, every time you got to make a choice on whether or not you want to, you know, which bill you want to catch up on or what bill you want to float because you don't think your utilities are going to get shut off or stupid shit like this, right? Like it impacts everything, you know? And I think that a lot of like, I notice that when you talk about like racism and shit, a lot of white people are like, well, it's not a big deal. If a guy comes up and calls you, you know, like a racial slur, like, is it really that big of a deal? And it's like, no. It's really not, and I think most minorities will admit as much, it's not really that much of a big deal for it to happen once. It's when it happens every single fucking day, or when different experiences happen every single fucking day for years and years and years, that it starts to wear on you, you know? When it becomes like a part of your daily existence.
It changes your psychology, too. It really it changes the way you think about the world. Like, I look at my dad. My dad grew up during the Great Depression. He's 87 years old. He was born in the late 20s. And my dad has seen some extreme poverty. The poor guy has seen such poverty that he told me growing up he's had to eat rats, and he said sometimes they were so hungry, they would bite their nails, they would swallow their own nails, and they would find mulberry leaves. And mulberry leaves are not very nutritious or tasty, for that matter. But he said they would find mulberry leaves and boil them and then drink the mulberry leaf broth, just so they would have enough sustenance to live another day. Sure. My dad has seen such extreme poverty that growing up, he planted seeds of every type of fruit and nut in our orchard, and which again, like at the time, was very cheap land, and he bought and built his own house on. That when the tree would grow fruit and nuts, he would feel unworthy of eating the fruit on the tree. So he would go and scavenge the fruit that had fallen on the ground and was rotting to eat that first, so as to not waste a single fruit that fell off that tree. Sure. And my mom would try to point out to him that we would have sometimes just bushels and bushels of apricots and cherries and peaches and all sorts of things. My dad would still pick the fruit that fell on the ground because he grew up, he knows what hunger is. He knows what that extreme poverty is. So it has changed his psychology. It's changed the way he thinks about the world. And it's really hard to undo that, I think. People take it for granted that you grow up in this stuff, and it shapes your worldview and your psychology.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Man, this has been a fascinating talk. I never expected to be here at this point.
Yeah, I mean, everybody has kind of had to think about these things over the past, I guess, 4 months since the inauguration, right?
Extreme poverty.
well, not necessarily that, but just, you know, taking up other perspectives and whatnot. Like, I would say that all these politics, I'm sure that everybody said this throughout all of United States history, but have been probably more divisive now than I can think of at any point in time, right?
Yeah, it's gotten bad. And again, I think a social network has a lot to do with it. I have to hit in just a minute, but I want to ask you a question before I go. I'm mm-hmm. curious. This is something that I spend a lot of time thinking about. Have you ever successfully persuaded someone politically or otherwise online?
It was only a single person. It was a 16-year-old, and he actually messaged me back the next day. I took the debate on as kind of like a funny thing, like, sure, we'll talk or whatever. But he was actually really articulate, and he messaged me the next day, and he was like, actually, you know, like, I'm reconsidering a lot of these things. Generally, the people that I talk to don't usually change their opinions, but usually I get emails from people that are kind of, basically this is the way these conversations work. You've got like, it's like the 40-40-20 thing for me. 40% are going to come out thinking that you were always right no matter what you say, because they are already in your ballpark. 40% of the people are always going to come out thinking that no matter what you said, you were fucking idiotic and dumb, because they're always against you ideologically, narratively. And then you've got the 20% in the middle. And I guess that's kind of who I aim for in these discussions. Like, these are the people who, if they're on the fence, I hope that the things that I say make enough sense that they kind of, you know, come over to my side, you know?
Yeah, well, that's interesting. So your approach is just to almost like it's a lost cause, the 240s, and you're just going for that hopeful, reasonable, rational middle, right?
Yeah, I try to argue my points as rationally as possible. I try to cite expert opinion in any field that I talk about. And I try to be like very, very, very consistent in all of my beliefs. I think the consistency is something that so many people lack. I don't know. I'm very big on everything. I extend the same courtesy to people I hate to people that I love. Right after the John Trump debate, like, I was very big on telling people, like, I don't support witch hunting him. I don't think that's a good idea. Yeah. There are a lot of people that say things like that. Like, well, you know, these things that the media does are bad. And then they turn around, and as soon as I'm on the opposite side, they start doing it to me. Like that Sargon dude, you know, was really mad. Did you follow anything with PewDiePie?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Sargon was really mad when PewDiePie, you know, got witch hunted by the media. After my conversation with JonTron, he started clipping out like 30-second snippets of my conversation with JonTron, and then labeling these videos saying like, "Oh, Destiny thinks all white people should shut up. Destiny thinks that communism is okay." And it's like, dog, what the fuck? Where the fuck is the perspective? Like, why you're doing the same thing to me that you get so mad with the other side's view? Like, why are you doing this? You know, like. That lack of consistency, I think, exists so much on both sides that it drives me fucking crazy. And that's all I look to bring, you know, to these types of discussions, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. I think consistency is so important. And thankfully, sometimes I'll test myself. Sometimes I will write down things or hold beliefs about things that I'll write down. And then sometimes I'll discover them later on and find that they are consistent with what I still believe. I'm like, oh, thank God.
Oh, a really good question. And it relates to something you were talking about earlier with people who are like really extreme and really set in their ways or whatever. A really good question to ask somebody if you feel like they're like insanely, if they're lost, ask somebody like, what would it take to change your mind about this thing? Right? That's a really good way to reveal. Like, I do that sometimes with like people for like the climate deniers. Like, what would it take to convince you that climate change was real? Right? And if they have to stop and think for like 20 minutes, maybe they'll realize you're being a little bit unreasonable. Like, does the world have to be on fire? do we have to, you know?
That's a really good approach. And I actually tried that recently. I was having a debate with someone and I said, what would it take for you to change to believe my position? What would it take for you to change your mind? Mm-hmm. And the person said, it would take this and this evidence. And then I provided them that evidence and that it, and here's what happened. And I predicted it. It's like, well, then they're going to attack the evidence or find some reason or some excuse to dismiss it. And I'm like, okay, well, I showed you the exact thing that you're asking for. And now you're trying to find reasons not to believe it. Yeah. And ultimately what that is confirmation bias. It all comes down to confirmation bias. You have a preconceived notion, you have a belief, and it's uncomfortable. The feeling of cognitive dissonance is uncomfortable. You don't want to feel like this belief that you have, this assumption you have about the world was wrong. Nobody likes that feeling. So we have to get around that. I'm really, really interested in the art of persuasion and arguments and what does and doesn't persuade people, especially with anti-vaxxers. I've been really curious about that for a long time.
Fuck, yeah. These people build up, not to go on for too much longer, you can leave whenever you need to, but like, if you've ever argued with like race realists or anti-vaxxers, like these people are so deep in their mind, and anytime you go to talk to them, dude, they get out like the fucking machine gun fire list of like the 400 links that they have that link to like every single alternative pseudoscience. And it's like, the problem when you debate people who are lost on this level is like, you need a fucking PhD in these fields to start rebuking what they're saying. Like, well, actually, you can see that vaccines are bad because in 1941, like the lead level and your genetics can be expressed with this thing. And it's like, I'm pretty sure this is all bullshit, but I don't have the level of expertise necessary to debate this, you know? And I don't even think you have the level of expertise necessary to understand this, but yeah.
Oh no, definitely not. You know what I have found does work? This gives me hope. I've been following the anti-vaxxer debate and just finding ways to persuade people, because that seems like such an important, paramount thing that we should all understand, is a really big danger to society if we don't get on board with it, which is vaccinations, right?
Yeah.
So there's this group that did the study. I think I read about this on Mother Jones, and they said that they were trying to persuade people who are anti-vaxxers into vaccinating their kids. And the way they approached it is they had four different approaches, four different groups, right? Mm-hmm. They had one group where they sent out pamphlets with a little description and a picture of what would happen to your kids if you didn't vaccinate. That didn't work. They had another group where they sent just the picture of the disease and like, you know, measles and mumps and all these terrible things that can happen to kids. That didn't work. Then they sent one that was just the description and even like some kind of voucher for like free vaccinations. That didn't work. And then they had a control group where they sent them nothing. And of course, that was just the control group. But they found after all this, it was very disheartening to the people who conducted the study. But they found that if they asked the participants of the study to think of a time that they were successful in life, or that they found themselves optimistic or hopeful, or they found themselves in like a good frame of mind, then they pitched them the vaccination stuff. That's when they were able to persuade them. It was only after they asked them to think about a time in their lives where they were successful or happy, and then once their frame of mind changed, then they were able to be persuaded. And I'm really, really curious about this. I'm looking for ways to try to see if this is an actual applicable strategy in arguments and debates. I don't know how you'd implement something like that, but that's fascinating to me.
Sure. Yeah, I definitely agree. If you want to look into another issue, you're going to have flat earthers are probably making a comeback soon. Now with all this NBA shit, you have a lot of, I think Shaq just came out and said, and is starting to get on board with it.
For real? Is that a real thing?
Yeah.
Is this really happening?
Yep.
Okay. Now here's this might be a I might sound like a conspiracy dipshit here.
Oh, but no. Are you a flat earther? Oh no, don't do this to me, dude.
Listen, you thought I was smart? I'm not. I'm an idiot. Here's you know the rapper B.O.B.?
Yeah. Rapper, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, so he came out like out of nowhere.
Oh, I remember. Park. Yeah, he's the one that started this shit. Yeah.
Right. Remember? He was like, oh, I'm a flat earther, right?
Uh-huh.
I was like, nah, come on. Come on, dude. You're not that much of an idiot. So I checked out his Twitter feed and looked at it, and it turned out, this is my own theory. I think I caught him on this, but he started talking about Flat Earth Society and Flat Earth Theory right around the time, conveniently, that his new album was going to drop. And since then, he hasn't talked much about it ever again. And I was like, oh, that's super convenient that you're getting thousands and thousands of tweets and people coming to your Twitter page right when your new album drops, and you don't really talk about Flat Earth Theory ever again after that. So I would be very curious to see if Shaq has something to promote, if he's pitching some new movie or some new project. I'd be very curious to see that.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I mean, he's kind of doing it in response to another guy, other NBA dude. I don't even fucking know who doing it. But yeah, you always have to wonder with celebrities if they're just saying crazy shit for attention. But
for publicity. Like, do you think Alex Jones is doing that? Do you think Alex Jones believes the stuff he's saying? Or is he doing it for, like, showboating for attention?
I don't know, man. Somebody gave an AMA a long time ago that used to work at Fox News, and they were saying that most of the people there bought in pretty heavily to everything that they were talking about, that it was kind of like a requirement to work there. So I don't know. It's really hard. Is it called Hanlon's Razor? Like, don't attribute to malice what can be attributed to stupidity. I mean, I don't know. Like, if you would have asked me, you know, 6 or 7 months ago, there were several times during Trump's campaign where I really thought that Trump was actually very, very, very intelligent. I thought that he was manipulating the media perfectly. I thought that he would know exactly when to pivot, that everything, like, he was just so intelligent, like playing the five-dimensional chess. But I mean, we're at the point now where you can see that Trump is actually a fucking buffoon. Like, he's actually just fucking insane. Like, literally lying every single day about facts and figures that he should know about and making crazy statement after crazy statement. Poor fucking Spicer is going to have a fucking heart attack. I can't imagine the next press conference, what, tomorrow morning, when he's got to go out and talk about how the wiretapping shit was all completely made up by Trump. Like,
oh man.
Yeah, I don't know. So, like, at some point, you have to wonder, like, do Kellyanne Conway, do all of these people, is everybody here buying into this? Or, I'm sorry, is everybody here, you know, like, just making it up for views? Or is there an actual ideological foundation, you know? And if you look at it, they've got a lot of fucking supporters that believe it. Why would it be so crazy for them to believe it, you know? So, I don't really know. That's a really hard question to ask, you know?
Oh man, that's disheartening. I mean, I feel like we are in a post-factual society.
Yeah,
I feel like
sure.
Facts. I feel like evidence, I feel like truth doesn't seem to matter anymore. And I don't know what the solution is. Maybe it's just disengagement. Maybe it's just, you know, let it run its course until it blows up in their faces and then clean up the mess. I don't know what else you can do.
Yeah, this, but the I've problem never, is that yeah. depending on the issue, it could take all of us with them. You know?
Right. Yeah. Oh, he seems to be the least diplomatic candidate I've ever seen in my life. He is fucking up shit with Germany. He's fucking up shit with China.
With Australia, with Mexico, yeah.
with Australia? How do you even piss off Australia?
Oh man.
How is US Australian relations a contemporary issue?
Oh man, because he just doesn't know anything about anything. He's just totally fucking clueless. Like, we need to fix the economy. Time to tariff every single product, like, coming from everybody to bring manufacturing. Like, what? None of these things exist in reality. They're like, even in China, they're losing their jobs to fucking robots. You think manufacturing jobs, the $80 an hour United Auto Worker jobs, are coming back to the United States? Like, come on, dude. Like, get fucking real. You want to tariff Mexico? Why? So poor people have to pay more for their fucking cars? Like, none of these businesses are eating the cost. You're a businessman. You should know this, right? Like, yeah, I don't know, dude. Yeah. Everything is fucking crazy, man.
Manufacturing is dead. The future of manufacturing is going to be 3D printers. That's it. Period. Game over, China. Sorry, you got to figure out a new economy. The future is going to be such a different economy than we've ever predicted. It's probably going to be entirely virtual goods, creating 3D models and virtual reality and stupid outfits that we can all buy and jerk each other off to in some second world type of game. Second Life type of game in virtual reality.
And everybody knows this. Every industry has had to deal with this. Nobody gets to go back to the past, right? Movies have to deal with piracy. Artists on the radio and shit had to get their music online to compete with torrent sites, right? They still aren't competing with them, right? Like, everybody has had to adapt and change and move on, right? Like, we're never going, like, people say, like, make America great again. Whatever you thought existed in the past, we're never going back to it, dog. Like, get on the fucking train. Like, we're going to the future. We'll drag you there kicking and screaming whether you want it. We're never having the high school dropout, $80 an hour, pension included after 25 years, manufacturing jobs. They're never going to be here. It's never going to happen, dude. They don't exist anywhere in the world. They're never existing here again, you know?
No, it's gone. Yeah. And as much as I actually argued with a real bona fide globalist recently, and he was like unabashedly a globalist. And mm-hmm. I thought, wow, this is fascinating. I've never actually, because you always hear that levied as a charge against
insult?
People. Always. As an insult, like Alex Jones, oh, he's a globalist. These globalists coming in, they want a national government. They want us to, mm-hmm. they want to attack our family. They want us all gay. And then what happens is, as we grow, as society grows, you have to become some global entity. Otherwise, what happens? I mean, do you want America to be a player, or do you want to be Estonia? Yeah. Estonia is a small government, and it's a small country. If they become part of something, then they have a little bit more political power. Eventually, when we start colonizing other planets, you're going to have literal global governments. Sure. And what do you call that? Of course, it's globalism. Then you're going to have interplanetary conflict. Oh, man, just nuke everything already.
The big problem is that people, the benefits of globalism are totally blind. Like, you will have an anti-globalist that goes out, right? He's eating at an Indian place, and the workers right. there came from another country, right? And then he drives home in his car where all of the parts were manufactured in Mexico. He gets home, you know, and he gets on his computer that he can afford because the silicon chips were manufactured in China, and the only reason he can afford all this, right? And then he gets online and he talks about how globalism is destroying the world, right? And the only reason right. he could afford any product in any part of this way and access to everything he has is because we've got these products manufactured from so much cheaper in other areas, you know, that we all capitalize on the advantages of one another. And like, and this is probably a guy who's like a second generation immigrant, right? And it's like damn, dude.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And the products, specifically Alex Jones shills, is made from herbs that come from India, from South America. Mm-hmm. The product was manufactured in Andorra. So there's no yeah. such thing as a non-global, like, if you're on YouTube, guess what? You're part of a global economy. You're yeah, part of globalism, dude.
For sure. And I say that yeah. about my shit all the time. Like, dude, like, if Africa was an amazing place, that's like an extra 1.5 billion fucking fans that I could get, dude. Like, I want these places to get online. And if you're a businessman, you want it too, right? You ship products out to people that you like. Dude, if you had a market in fucking South America, if you had a market in Africa, if you had a market in, you know, like, East Asia and shit, like, this is good. You want to be able to sell products to these people and shit, you know?
Yeah, that'd be amazing. Why does trade only have to be interstate? Interstate trade only, yeah. period. That's insane. Anyway, man, I should probably head in just a minute. But, dude, this has been a fascinating talk. I'd love to do this again sometime.
Yeah, sure, anytime. Or if you've got a podcast you want me to drop by or whatever, I would always love to.
I'd love that.
I'll save my jerking off for the end or whatever, because I know how annoying it is when people do this to me. But, yeah, I loved all your articles and everything growing up. I actually got in really big trouble once in high school because I printed off one of them, and I took it with me back in the days with my printers to share with friends at school because we didn't have fucking computers there. And, yeah, it was really, really sick reading all of your shit and getting to meet my – it's always funny now growing up, like getting to meet like some of my like childhood people that shaped a lot of, you know, how I think and whatnot. So yeah, it's been really cool to talk and whatnot.
Wow, that's an honor to hear, and thank you so much. I mean, I'm flattered that's the case. And look, dude, when my new book comes out, I'll send you a copy too. That'll be
fucking awesome, dude.
Yeah, I would love for you, love to get your opinion, your input on it too, because I think it's a lot of what we talked about today, it'll probably resonate with you.
Now that you're super like cocked and blue pilled and everything, is it going to be called like the alphabet of feminism or some shit? <'Cause>
You know, it's funny. I did. Yeah, I'm like I'm a super cuck now. what happened is
A is for affirmative action. But yeah,
actually, I did pitch to the publisher the alphabet of womanliness as told by a man sure. a long time ago, and I wanted it to be a flip of the alphabet of manliness. So you flip it on the other side, and instead of a guy punching a gorilla, it's like a woman dusting a bust of a gorilla or something like that. And sure. it's just a pure satire of my own book, essentially. Mm-hmm. But the publisher's like, well, we've never had a flip book that sold well. I'm like, well, how many flip books are published? Anyway, long story short, we ended up going with the numbers of manliness. That was the compromise. But sure. yeah, I mean, that's, you know, there's a lot of a lot of fun stuff that you can do there.
Yeah. Okay, cool, dude. I really appreciate the convo.
Anyway, buddy, yeah, super fascinating, really good talk. Let's do this again sometime, and I'd love to have you. You're always welcome on the podcast as well. We'll do it. We'll hopefully do it soon.
Yeah, cool. I'll see you later, man.
All right, buddy. Talk soon.
Learn about self-publishing. I don't know if you can. Can you self-publish physical books? I know that doing the ebook self-publishing is really easy. What?